Hallelujah. All right, we now go to the session of God's Word. And we're just going to continue from where we stopped last week in a study of Luke chapter 5, verse 17 to 26. Luke chapter 5, verse 17 to 26. And the title of the message, which we started last week, and we're going to conclude today, is Miracles Start from the Heart. Amen? Miracles start from the heart. God wants to grant us miracles. Amen. God wants to bless us. God specializes in doing the impossible. Amen. If there's any situation, if there's any circumstance in our lives which looks impossible, those are the kind of things that God wants to work on. He says, I am the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? Nothing is hard for our Lord. Amen? You know, when the angel of the Lord visited Elizabeth in the book of Luke chapter 1 and was telling her, he visited Mary actually, in the book of Luke, visited Mary, he said to her, he said, and your cousin Elizabeth, who was married, is now pregnant for 6 months. Hallelujah. He says, for with God, nothing shall be impossible. Hallelujah. So concerning your situation this morning, I bring good news that with God, that situation that has been impossible will become possible in the name of Jesus Christ. So, of course, the best thing to learn is to look at the life of Jesus and what he taught us. Hallelujah. So let's go to Luke chapter 5, where we started studying last week. Luke chapter 5, I'm reading here from verse 17 to verse 26. Luke chapter 5, verse 17 to verse 26. He says, now it happened on a certain day. Your miracle will happen on a certain day. Amen. Sometimes we are waiting for that special day. Sometimes we are waiting for that special moment. But God can visit you on any day of the week, on a certain day, on a day when we are not expecting, on a time. Sometimes we are giving up on our miracles. We are giving up on what God will do in our life. But then He just comes on a certain day. My prayer for you is that when the Lord visits you, you will recognize His visitation in the name of Jesus. Because many people go about their businesses and they go about things and they're like, okay, I know God will visit me. It looks like He will visit January in the new year. And yet God is saying, I am not done with you yet in December. It's my year of signs and wonders. May you experience signs and wonders in Jesus' name. Now it happened on a certain day as He was teaching that the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, that they were the Pharisees and the teachers of the law sitting by, don't sit by in God's presence. Amen. Connect with your heart, because miracles start from the heart. These men were sitting by. They were not concerned. It didn't matter that Jesus was speaking. It didn't matter what He had to say. They were only there to criticize. They were only there to talk about what was not working. He says the Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting by. But they had gone out of every town of Galilee, Judea, and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was present to heal them. You will not waste the power of the Lord in the name of Jesus. You will not waste your anointing in the name of Jesus. You will not waste the presence of the Lord that has brought your miracles in the mighty name of Jesus. The power of the Lord was present to heal them, but they were not happening to it because they were just sitting by. Verse 18. Then behold, people were going to happen to cut out. Then behold, men brought on a bed a man who was paralyzed, who they sought to bring and lay before him. Last week, we learned that people around us are crying out for healing, and we need to bring them to Jesus. Amen. This man was paralyzed. This man could not help himself, but he had. He had people who brought him to Jesus. He had people who said, we're not going to leave you in this condition. they brought him to Jesus. Verse 19. And when they could not find how they might bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the housetop and let him down with his bed through the tiling into the midst before Jesus. Lastly, we learned that don't give up when you meet with obstacles on your way to your miracle. Amen. Don't give up. You have prepared. You have set your mind that you are going to finish that course. And yet a problem occurs along the line. Don't give up. You have set your mind to get a job this year. And you have applied. But the answer has been a consistent no. Don't give up. You have set up your mind that that child will serve God. That child will please God. But it's not happening right now. And you feel like giving up. Don't give up. Don't give up on your way to your miracle. Amen. This man brought their friend to Jesus. But there was so much power. There was so much talking people. They couldn't get to Jesus. And I bet you people were saying to them, you know what? Come back tomorrow. You know what? Jesus is busy today. Maybe you have come earlier. The service starts at 10. But if you get here at 6 a.m., then you'll be able to see Jesus. But this man said, we're not going to take no fathers. Hallelujah. And God is looking for people who will say, we will not take no fathers. When Abraham couldn't have a child, the Bible says, Abraham against hope, he lived in hope. When there was no hope, when his body was dead, when his wife Sarah had passed the age of giving birth, Abraham still believed. And the Bible recorded, it says that Abraham believed God, and he was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. May you, by your faith, become a friend of God in the name of Jesus. Don't give up too easily. Don't give up very easily. Oh, I tried. He said, how many times have you applied for the job? He said, I have put in 10 applications. 10 applications. And I have received a no. I've given up. I'm not looking for a job again. I just go with benefits. I just say, oh, God will do it in his own time. As if God is going to apply for a job for us. Amen. God will do it in his own time. No, there is what God expects us to do by faith. Don't give up on your miracle. This man will not get to Jesus. So, Lord, what do we do? We will go to the roof. And I said last week, can you imagine carrying a man who is paralyzed, carrying him up the stairs to the roof? The man must have been begging them. We don't need to see Jesus today. We can always come back. Those carrying me up the roof. What if I drop and I fall? Then my condition will be worse than it was before I get to Jesus. I'm paralyzed already. I said, be careful of the naysayers. Turn a deaf ear to the naysayers. There are vision killers around. Their role is to tell you why that thing will not work. How can you combine your job and study and family together? What are you looking for? Just you can study to maybe in 10 years' time. Maybe when you retire, then you can study. Naysayers, be careful of them. People who will always find a reason why that thing you want to do will not work. Lately, I mean, in the last few days, it wasn't just naysayers I had. I had people who, on behalf of God, are naysayers. You know, that's another level. It's one level for somebody to tell you that something will not work. It's another level for somebody to tell you that what God is telling me is that that thing you are going to do is dangerous. It will not work. Meanwhile, you have prayed. Meanwhile, you have peace. Meanwhile, you know God's word itself. And some of us, we may take those words and allow it to plant fear in our hearts. And then we suffer. But that is not God's will. Amen. So let's be careful of vision that people, there's some people, they will never come to you with positive prophecy. They will never say to you that I dread yesterday, and I saw you become the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. They don't have those kind of prophecies. Oh, I dreamt, and I saw four children, and I saw you in this private house, and I saw glory. I saw you become a director. I saw you own your business. I saw great things happening to you. They don't have that kind of prophecy. Their prophecy is always, I saw big cats chasing you. And at the point when they were about to bite you, I woke up. So you begin to think, did they bite me or not? Because you woke up. So you don't know. Only negative prophecy. But the Bible tells me that the gospel is good news. So when all you get is just negative prophecy, even the prophet himself has to review that is God really speaking to me? Because what was scripture? You know, there's a pattern you find in the Old Testament. That this is not even the message today, but this is what God is saying. There's a pattern you find in the Old Testament. Go through all the books, Babylon. Even when the prophet is saying there will be destruction, there will be desolation, you will go into captivity, there will always be good news there of restoration. He will say, I will visit you. After you have gone into captivity, I will bring you back. I will restore you. I will put my law in your heart. I will be your people. And you will be my people, and I will be your God. Because I cannot do with an everlasting law. That is the scripture. So when we get this gospel of bad news, only evil. Ah, I saw an accident. Oh, I saw a coffin. I saw the devil. I saw. We've got to be careful that we don't allow the enemy use us to plant bad news in the hearts of people. To plant fear in the heart of people. The Bible tells me, 1 John 5:4, he says, this is the victory that overcomes the world. Even our faith. We are the people of faith. We believe in God, and God fights for us. And because of that, we have victory. Hallelujah. He says, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. If they see a thousand witches surrounding you, they're spitting out incantations, it does not change the fact that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. One with God is the majority, anywhere in time. So we're not going to be in fear. Beware of naysayers. All they have is bad news. Beware of them. Some of them have not been sent by God. And even if God gives you a bad news, or this thing might happen to this person, that same God will give you the solution to the problem. That will, if you do X and Y, end of story. Hallelujah. Amen. This man was their friend. And when they couldn't get to Jesus, they went to the room and go back in there. That was where we stopped last week. So let's continue. I might not finish the chapter I was reading. Hallelujah. Verse 20. He says, this is where we start from today. He says, when he saw their faith, when Jesus saw their faith, he said to him, to the man, the paralyzed man, man, your sins are forgiven you. And the scribe and the Pharisees began to be saying, who is this? Who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sin but God alone? But when Jesus perceived, did you receive the sadness in Jesus' name? When Jesus perceived, there are so many people smiling at you, who you should run away from. Did you receive the sadness in the name of Jesus? I was speaking to one of my mentees yesterday, and I said, your boss at work can come with a question. The same question he or she asks every day. But on that day, you are required to give a different answer. May you have discernment to know how to give a different answer on that day in the name of Jesus. Every day, she comes and says, how are you? How are you getting on? And you go, oh, I'm fine, oh, I'm well, or oh, yeah, I'm busy, and all that. But suddenly, an opportunity has come up. A promotion has come up. And he's looking for somebody to fill that post. And he comes to you and he says, how are you? How are you getting on? And all he wants to hear on that day is that, yes, I'm on top of things. Things are working well. The whole thing is set to work. We're doing what we are meant to do. So he can recommend you. That is not the day to tell him, on other days you might be able to do that, but on this particular day, you have to give the right answer. I pray for you, when your interview comes for your promotion, you will give the right answer in the name of Jesus. Some of us are waiting for that formal interview, when we are called in and we are sat down and we are questioned, not knowing that maybe informal interviews lead to promotion. May God visit you in Jesus' name. Amen. But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, the answer said to them, why are you listening in your hearts? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, rise up and walk? But I will know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. He said to the man who was paralyzed, I say to you, arise. The Lord is saying to somebody, arise. I said the Lord is saying to somebody, arise. You will rise up in the name of Jesus Christ. He said, I said to you, arise. Take up your bed and go to your house. Think about God, the Lord. Verse 25. Immediately he arose before them, took up the bed he had been lying on, and departed to his own house, glorifying God. And with the Lord had this, and they glorified God and were filled with fear, saying, we have seen strange things today. Can you imagine this man who had not walked almost for how long? When he was on his way back home, carrying his bed and walking, people who had seen him lying down for years suddenly saw him walking. And they said, we have seen strange things today. Your testimony will cause men to become known to God in the name of Jesus Christ. We have seen strange things today. Hallelujah. As we normally do, let's pick out a few lessons from the chapter, from verse 20, that we have read. So he said, man, your sins are forgiven. Now, why is that? Sickness and death are the outcomes of a fallen nature. Sickness and death are the outcomes, the results of a fallen nature. Sickness and death are the outcomes of a fallen nature, and only God can truly heal us. Sickness and death are the outcomes of a fallen nature, and only God can truly heal us. Jesus forgave the man before he healed him, because he knew that sin was the problem. And this was sin he had inherited from Adam. It is possible that maybe his own personal sin left his condition, or just because he had inherited the nature from Adam, and that's why he had been afflicted. Either way, sin was the root cause of his sickness, and he needed to be forgiven before he could be healed. We all need forgiveness. Amen. That's why we need to pray for people who are ill, that the Lord will touch them and forgive them and heal them. Hallelujah. Sickness and death are the outcomes of our fallen nature. Many people wonder, why do people fall sick? It is because we inherited death from Adam. But Jesus has come to give us life. And may that might be our portion in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Verse 21, he says, and the scribes and the Pharisees a minister, don't miss God's visitation. Don't miss God's visitation because he has not come in the way you are expecting him. Don't miss God's visitation because he has not come in the way you are expecting him. The scribes and the Pharisees didn't realize that the Messiah was in their midst. They didn't realize that God himself was with them in human form. So when he said, "Your sins are forgiven you," they were like, "Who is this man? Ordinary man taking the place of God." Not knowing, not realizing that God was right there in their midst. Many a time we pray for visitation from our Lord. We pray for revival. We pray that God should touch us. And yet when God comes, we don't recognize it. But I remember the story of Abraham. Amen. I remember the story of Abraham. In Genesis chapter 18, Abraham saw men. And he went to them. And he hosted them. And the Bible says he hosted them. He not knowing that they were angels. And the Lord granted him his heartfelt desire. So don't miss God's visitation because he has not come in the way you expect. If you expect that he will come in human form, he might decide to come through a government initiative. He might decide to come through a business. He might decide to come through enemies. All you need to do is make sure that you are expected and the Lord will visit you in Jesus' name. See the last same verse, verse 21. He says, "Who is this who speaks blasphemies? Who is this who speaks blasphemies?" And I wrote that pride will deny us of our miracles. Who is this? They were spiteful of him. They despised God who was standing right in front of them. They spoke unadvisedly in the presence of the Most High God. They said, "Who is this?" They did not have any regard for him. They had no compassion for the man who was ill, the man who was about to get his own miracle. All they could think about is, we know too much to know that what he had just said is wrong, not knowing that it was God speaking in their ears. Pride can deny us of a miracle. When God is saying, "We bend for that season," when God said, "That man is not," he said, no, I'm okay, it's the way I've chosen to do my life. Sometimes bitterness, anger, unforgiveness continues because somebody just refuses to say sorry. As simple as that. Just, "I'm sorry I did the wrong thing." Or, "Okay, maybe I'm not my fault, I'm sorry anyway." I hear people say, "I'd rather die than say sorry." And we die without saying sorry. May the Lord help us in Jesus' name. Pride will deny people, will deny us of our miracle. The power of God was present to heal the Pharisees, but they couldn't tap into it because of their pride. Now, this is what verse 2. He said, "For when Jesus perceived their thoughts and prayed for him," that is that, "ask God for discernment. It will reveal to you what others are thinking." Amen. Ask God for what? Discernment. Discernment is the ability to know what another is thinking, just like intuition. You just know whether the spirit of the Lord is at work or not. That's why I said, when you are asked a question, discernment will tell you what kind of answer you should give to that question. Sometimes even our children will come to us and ask us a question, and they have something else at the back of their mind. Discernment will tell you that question is just introductory. There is something else that you want to address. And sometimes you miss our spirits. They start off with a simple question and just go, "Oh, why are you thinking about that? Why are you saying that?" And then they don't worry. And the real thing is still in their hearts. Discernment will let you know that that person smiling to you is smiling genuinely, or if it is an enemy. Discernment will let you know that that person is calling you or that's a lie. The power of discernment. Amen. We need discernment. Discernment will help you test spirits. When someone is against you, discernment will tell you, stay clear of that person. That person is against you. We test spirits through discernment. When you receive a prophecy, discernment will help you interpret it, whether it is God or not. People will tell you things and be just like, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for saying that to me. It's okay. I'll go and pray about it. But if you don't have discernment, you just swallow everything, boom, lie, and sinker. And that's not God's will. So I said, ask for discernment. It will reveal to you what others are thinking. The Pharisees did not say a word to Jesus. They were sitting by as if they were not interested. And when he said, your sins are forgiven, straight away in their hearts, they attacked Jesus. Who is this? Who is this who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sins for God alone? But the creator of the universe, the maker of heaven and earth, the one who knows the thoughts in your heart, the one who gives you the mind and the will to even think the thoughts, the one who created them, knew exactly what they were thinking. As they were thinking it in their heart, he was seeing it clearly. And he said to them, why are you listening in your heart? May the Lord give you wisdom to know how to speak the right word that will discern your enemies even more, Jesus. You know, it's like he was speaking to the man, because it was that man, your sin has forgiven you, and all that. And suddenly he turned. He said, why are you listening in your heart? You can imagine the shock on their face. That how did he know? Because only God can truly reveal secrets of the heart. God said to Samuel, he said, when Samuel said, when Eliah saw Jesse's first son, when he came before Samuel and wanted to be anointed as king, God said to Samuel, he said, I have refused him. He said, for man looks on the outside, but I God look where on the inside. So if they ever thought that Jesus was not a prophet, the fact that he could tell them what they were thinking in their heart was proof. And was said by God. Amen. Discernment will reveal what others are thinking to you. Discernment will tell you that child is planning to do X tomorrow, and then you put something in place today so that they don't do it tomorrow. That's the power of discernment. Discernment will tell you that child is confused. This is what he or she needs to do. And you go to the child, the child. When the child is a little child, like, God won't say that. Wow. That's the time you want to be. That's the power of discernment. It's a very effective tool that God has released upon men. Amen. Verse 23. Jesus said, which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or rise up and walk. But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. He said to the man who was paralyzed, I say to you, to your hearts. Hallelujah. God will change your story in an instant through the power of his word. Amen. I say God will change your story in an instant through the power of his word. Jesus said to the man, arise, take up your bed and go to your house. It did not take another 7 months for this man to heal. Amen. It did not take another 7 years for this man to heal. It did not take 7 hours for the man to be healed. It did not even take 7 minutes for the man to be healed. I doubt if it took 7 seconds for the man to be healed, because he rose up immediately. May the Lord do the same in your life in Jesus' name. May his power change your story in the mighty name of Jesus. Is that miracle giving you a portion in the mighty name of Jesus Christ? You see, Jesus' word carries power to give life to men. Amen. Jesus' word, God's word, carries power to give life to men. That's why we pray his word, because it carries power to give life to men. Amen. And as we round up this morning, write down these two things. Your miracle will bring praises to God. Amen. Your miracle will bring praises to God. Amen. And finally, what visitation from God will turn you from zero to hero? What visitation from God will turn you from zero to hero? This man had been known as being on the bed for so long. But when he was healed, he rose up, he took his bed, glorifying God, and began to walk to his own house. Something he hadn't done for years. Suddenly, he was the hero of the village. He was the hero of the city. He had been on the bed, but now he was walking. And I pray for you also that when God visits you, you will change your story from zero to becoming a hero in the mighty name of Jesus. May the Lord bless you, may the Lord be with you, may the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord grant you peace in all that you do. In the mighty name of Jesus. Shall we bow our eyes to pray? Father, we thank you and we worship you. We thank you because you are a miracle working God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. In this season of Christmas, we celebrate you. We celebrate the things you have done in our lives. We celebrate the miracles, the signs, the wonders that you have performed in our lives and in the lives of others. We pray, Lord, that we continue to draw closer to you. With expectant hearts in the mighty name of Jesus. For all who have joined us this morning, may your blessings be upon us. We love you, Father, we exalt you. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Amen. Amen.